Shus Evangelia of Mantel. Wherever I listen. I echo the words of Samson Bethlehem, who spoke of his humility, his awe, at standing just a few inches away from where his grandfather spoke. I remember the times, many Shabbosos, when my wife, Alav Shalom, and I were in Washington Heights and down here in the Kehilla, and listening to Rav Breuer Zatzal, listening to Rav Schwab Zatzal, and being overcome with Yiras HaKovod, hearing people who actually lived what they spoke, as Mantel said about Rabbeinu Hirsch. It's a humbling experience. It's a privilege and an honor for a son of Ostun, an affirmative action member of this Kehilla, to be asked to address you today on this truly awesome occasion. 25 years ago, the 100th Yahrzeit, there was a gathering here in the United States in the Marriott Hotel of descendants. They gave us name cards to know which of the children we're descended from. My wife is a Sarah. And there was another parallel gathering in Yerushalayim, where 1,000 people attended. 1,800 people altogether, descendants of Reb Shamshon Raphael Hirsch. Every single one, Scherman Torah mitzvahs. Haredi, not Haredi, but every single one, Scherman Torah mitzvahs. And I wondered at the time, and I wonder today, of how many Gedolei Olam can you make such a statement, especially in the aftermath of the Holocaust? How many of the great Gedolei, the great teachers of yesteryear, could say, Bishmei Meraimim, then it was 1800, today certainly much more than 1800. 1800 plus descendants, all of them, Shomer Torah mitzvahs. And this at a time when, as we know all too well, if we needed the Pew study to remind us, we have that. When assimilation is so rampant, when people who say they regard themselves as Jews and they're proud to be Jews because it's essential to a Jew to have a sense of humor. And that's the extent of their Jewishness. Over 1,800 descendants, Shomer Torah mitzvahs. Our children, our grandchildren, speaking about myself, cannot begin to appreciate the significance of this because, Baruch Hashem, we live in communities, yeshiva communities, Balabatisha communities, we live Washington Heights, Lakewood, Muncie, Flatbush, Borough Park, Baltimore, wherever it is. We're surrounded by Yiddishkeit. We're surrounded by Torah. In 1943, General Rommel, Nazi Germany's greatest general, stood at the banks of the Suez Canal and was ready to attack, to go to Eretz Yisrael. In the Jewish agency, they were burning documents so that they would not fall into the hands of the Nazis, Yimash Shmo. There are only a few hundred Talmidim of Yeshivas Gedolos in the whole country. And in the United States, whenever there was an affair of some major Jewish organization, the local Orthodox rabbi would be called upon to make hamitz, the invocation. And that was it. The affair, almost every single time, was treif. mainstream Jewish organizations. Nobody criticized Orthodox Jews then, because you don't criticize a crisis. Orthodoxy was moribund. A few yeshivas here and there. You could count them on the fingers of one hand. Chassidus Yehudaim say that the worst word in the Hebrew language is yish, despair, hopelessness. When somebody is hopeless, you know, somebody can be very, very ill, and as long as he fights, as long as he hopes, as long as he wants to live, there's still a possibility. When you give up, then your days are numbered. Kehilla Yisroel was not Miyayish. Kehilla Yisroel was not Miyayish. Kehilla Yisroel did not give up. And Baruch Hashem, that's why we're here today. And that's why our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, wherever they are, make us proud. Make us proud of our heritage, because it is their heritage as well. My cousin David Klugman told me, just before Maariv, that a grandchild of Rabbi Hirsch, they had to write a matzeva, they had to write a nusach for the matzeva. And they asked Rabbi Yankee to come and ask his atzal to write the nusach, and they wanted to include Nin the Mechad, Rabbi Shamshon for Hirsch. And Rabbi Yankee added, Roish, Rashka Bahad, Raish Gadlus of Yisroel. And they said to him, well, he wasn't. He was great in Germany, but he wasn't the fall of Kehilla Yisroel. And Rabbi Yankee said, in his lifetime, that was true. But today, he was the leader of all of Kehilla Yisroel, because without him, Chalil and Torah might have been forgotten from Kehilla Yisroel. And this comes from a Litvish Rosh Hashiva. Let me read to you from the first letter of the 19 letters. I wonder, most of you probably know, but it's worth mentioning for those who don't. You know, the 19 letters was written almost as an afterthought. Rav Hirsch, he was only 27 years old. Remarkable, it's amazing. He was only 27 years old when he wrote Chorev. Chorev encompasses Kol HaTorah Kula. At the age of 27, it's almost unimaginable that one human being could do that. And he wanted to have it published, and no Jewish publisher would touch it, because this was Germany, which was under the domination of reform. He found a non-Jewish publisher and said, Chorev is a very large work, and it's a very risky undertaking, and if you can produce something smaller, a smaller manuscript, I'll take a chance. And if it's popular, then I'll do Chorev. So Rav Hirsch wrote the 19 letters. And it revolutionized. It revolutionized the country. And then Chorev was published. Let me read to you from the first letter of the 19 letters. A letter from, as Rav Mantel told us, someone whom Rav Hirsch called Binyamin. And who is Binyamin? Binyamin is a childhood friend of Rav Hirsch, of the apocryphal Naftali. And Naftali became a Talmud Chacham, became a Rav, became a leader in Kehilla Yisroel, and Binyamin drifted away. And they met. And you know, two old friends, you know, if you meet somebody, have a reunion, you meet somebody from 30, 40 years ago, you know, it's a joyous occasion, and you're back to your youth, and they were back to their youth, and they spoke. And Naftali asks Binyamin, what happened to you? And here are some of the things that Binyamin said. I won't read you the whole thing, just a few things. Why did I leave the Torah? Because the Torah law itself forbids every enjoyment. It's a hindrance to all the pleasures of life. For 2,000 years, we have been tossed around by others like a plaything, a bouncing ball, and we are, even at this time, banished from all paths of happiness. As for perfecting our human qualities, what culture, what conquests in the domain of science, art, or invention? In a word, what great achievements have Jews wrought in comparison with the Egyptians, the Phoenicians, the Greeks, the Romans, the Italians, the French, the English, or Germans, and if you were writing today, you would have said the Americans? By the Torah's laws that ensure our isolation in life, it arouses at the very least suspicion and hostile distrust. By imposing a life of isolation, it indeed removes every incentive for exertion in science and art, and therefore they do not flourish among us. Do these questions, these condemnations sound familiar? They should. Because the vast majority of American Jews and the vast majority of Jews all over the world could say the very same thing, in different words, but the very same thing. May I give you an example? There's a new movement that calls itself Open Orthodoxy. Open Orthodoxy. And here's what Open Orthodoxy has to say. I couldn't make this up. Calls itself Orthodoxy, but Open Orthodoxy. Its rabbinic leaders have denied the divine authorship of the Torah. Not all of them, but many of them. And even those who say that the Torah was given by a Kodesh Baruch and Har Sinai say that, well, it's legitimate to question it. We don't believe that, but it's legitimate to think so. Have denied the divine authorship of the Torah. Have condoned denial of the existence of the Avos and the Imois, of Yetzias Mitzrayim, and of Matan Torah at Har Sinai. The Rosh Yeshiva of their institution has referred to the commands of the Akedah and the Rechias HaMolech as, quote, immoral, end quote. He wrote that Avram was a negligent father who did not love Yitzchak, that Yaakov was socially inept and only knew how to lash out when confronted by a problem. Another of them wrote that Avraham Avinu failed the test of the Akedah. He should have refused. They campaigned to promote gay marriage. And it's another quote. For me, halacha is not about blind, irrational submission, but about intentional transformation, tikkun atzmi, tikkun kehilla, tikkun olam. They leave out the part about tikkun olam, the second olam, the shakai. While it's deeply rooted in the past and guided by core Torah values, it's primarily geared to the future-looking, that's not Open Orthodoxy, to help solve societal problems. So we're not solving our problems. We're solving society's problems. We're telling society what to do. To bring holiness into our lives and cultivate the ethical personality, not the personality of Avraham Avinu, who obeyed HaKadosh Baruch Hu, if there is HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who obeyed HaKadosh Baruch Hu to bring his son to the Akedah. No, that's immoral, that's unethical. But we have to cultivate the ethical personality. So, Binyamin is still around. Binyamin is still around, going by different names, but he's still here, he's still among us. And that's really the miracle of Rav Shmuel Fol Hirsch. You read it. The German is it's the German of the middle 19th century. It's archaic. The literal English translation of the Hirsch Chumash is hard. It's hard to read because it follows the German. The translator was a son, or was it a grandson of Rav Hirsch. But English was not his first language, and you can tell. The new translation is altogether different. It's eye-opening. But when you read it, and many of you have, because many of you participated in this seal of all the writings of Rav Shamshon Fol Hirsch, when you read it, it speaks to this generation. It really does. It's amazing. It's amazing that a religious thinker, a religious philosopher, if you want to call him that, writing 175 years ago, could be speaking to us, speaking to the Benjamins of our time. Rabbi Solanter, founder of the Muslim movement, a goyim adir in every way, Rabbi Solanter said he doesn't know if there's an olam haba that's big enough to contain Rav Shamshon Fol Hirsch. When the Kovner Rav was asked about somebody who wanted to translate the Hirsch Chumash into Lashon Kodesh, he said, by all means do it, and he suggested make two parts. One part should be the Lumdus, the Halacha, especially in Sefer Vayikra, and the rest should be the commentary on the Torah itself. One of the Gedolei Hadars, the Yitzchak Kalkun inspector, Kovner Rav, Paisik Hador, said that Rav Hirsch's commentary should be translated as a parish on Teres Kayanin, not only on a rabbiner sermonizing on the Chumash. Rav Shlomo Feivelman, the Lodge, who was the father of Torah in America, anybody who knows his story and the history of Torah community in America knows this. He said, I cannot understand how it's possible for an American yeshiva student to be Jewish without reading the 19 letters. I was once thinking of asking for a show of hands. How many people here have read the 19 letters? How about, oh, good for you, but I'm sure the hands will not go up, so I don't want to go, how do I do that? How many of our children and our grandchildren have read the 19 letters? I had the very good fortune when I was 14 years old. It was an older bacher in Torah Vadas, Yankel Greenwald, who now is a great, great, great person. He had a copy of he befriended me, several years older than I. And he lent me Rabbi Drachman's translation of the 19 letters. Translation written in the 1890s, also rather archaic. And when I was 14, I lived in Newark, and I used to take the train and the bus and another back home every Friday, and I used to read it on the way. It made a profound impression on me. Personally, I became familiar with Hirsch's writing because I had the privilege of teaching for several years evenings in the Rika Breuer Seminary. And I taught Chumash based on the Perushim of Rav Hirsch. It was eye-opening. It was astounding. There's no way that I can encapsulate the greatness of Rav Hirsch. I want to talk about just a couple of topics. One, community. Community, Kehilla. And I quote from Rav Hirsch. Every Jewish community represents Israel within a limited geographical territory. And within this limited territory, each Jewish community must discharge all the great tasks that have been set for Israel as a whole. For this purpose only, the Jewish community is vested with its authority over the individual. Now, that's a profound statement. How many Kehillas are there in the world, aside from Hasidus? But but among other communities in the world, how many are there that you can call a Kehilla where the individual is bound to the decisions of the Kehilla? Very, very few. Very, very few, when it's a tragedy. Because when you lose the sense of Kehilla, you lose much of the sense of what Klal Yisrael is supposed to be. The Gifter Zatzal once said to me, he said, there has never been a Bashafinish, a creation like the American Yeshiva book. He wants his Rosh Hashiva to tell him everything. He wants Rosh Hashiva to tell him what color socks to wear. But let the Rosh Hashiva once tell him something that he doesn't like. No more Godel. Rav Hirsch is talking about Kehilla. The Kehilla is the macrocosm of Klal Yisrael. It represents the mission of Klal Yisrael as a whole, and therefore, for that reason, and only for that reason, the individual has to subjugate himself to the Kehilla. He goes on, Israel is like a tree whose vital strength is replicated independently in each of its branches, twigs, leaves, and root fibers. This tree may be felled. You can chop down the tree. Its trunk may be split, its branches chopped off. Its broken parts may be scattered far and wide. But even the tiniest of these scattered remnants, if given the proper soil, is capable of striking new roots. The tiny remnant can reproduce the whole tree. Such is the strength of Israel in exile. Rabbi Sai, the tiny remnant can reproduce the whole tree. At this bima, Rav Royer Zatzal stood. At this bima, Rav Schwab Zatzal stood. Both of them remnants of Hershey in Germany. And what did they reproduce? They reproduced the tree. And that, he said, is the purpose for which God endowed Judaism with the rich treasures of his mitzvahs, which uplift the humblest, enrich the poorest, unite even the most isolated with God. Mitzvahs transform his hovel into a temple, his table into an altar, his bread into offerings. This is a Kehilla. This is a Kehilla. It's a Kehilla which set an example for many, many others. Hashem Yisbarach gave the remnants of the Kehilla to continue here in Washington Heights and to reproduce wherever they are. Wherever they are. Another point I wish to make, which to me, not very bright, certainly not an expert in Rabbi Hirsch, but to me symbolizes what he stood for and what he taught. How do you read Tanakh and how do you understand the Torah? How do you understand the Gemara? How do you understand what Chazal are telling us? A friend of mine told me he once visited Rav Breuer, and Rav Breuer said to him, Yeshiva Bacher, Talmud Chacham, a real Talmud Chacham. And he said to him, you think that Yeshaya and David HaMelech have nothing to teach you? To Rav Hirsch, Tanakh and Talmud go together. You want to know what Yiddishkeit is, what the Rabbeinu Shalom says? Tanakh and Talmud. He did not have an easy life. You know, we like to think that Rav Hirsch came and he revolutionized the world and he was a Mashiach and everybody followed him, he was a piper and everybody did whatever he did. No, not at all. Not at all. Whatever he did, he faced opponents, he faced difficulty. There were Gedolei Torah in Germany who opposed what he wanted. But what he stood for endures. It endures. As Rabbi Yaakov Kamenetsky said, he is the Rosh, Kol B'nai Agayla. Whatever we are, we owe to him. When Rav Shlomo Breuer came to open the yeshiva in Frankfurt, he was opposed. People said, Rav Hirsch didn't have a yeshiva. He didn't have a yeshiva very well. Government regulations and the opposition of people even within his home, Kehilla prevented him from opening yeshiva. But to him, he expected, and he writes this, every Jew should know Shas, Tanakh and Shas. But he was not able to carry out that dream in his lifetime. As a matter of fact, the hours of the Lulikaydish, between 5 and 7 hours a week. The government was involved. The government controlled education. And there was a Kehilla to deal with. But Rav Shlomo Breuer opened the yeshiva. I had a teacher, a mentor in Torah Vadas, Rav Moshe Lana, Zichrono Livracha, who was a Talmud. And the yeshiva from Frankfurt, where Rav Yosef Breuer was Rosh Yeshiva. And he said, once a year, all the Talmudim in the Beis Medrash stood on a stage, and the whole Kehilla was invited, and these boys were tested in front of everybody. I would have run away. He says he remembers one of the questions that they were asked was, how many times does Tosfos, I don't remember if he said in Gittin or in Ksubas, how many times does Tosfos quote Rabbeinu Pater? And they had to know that. And the whole Kehilla was sitting out front, and they were, and these helpless young Bachur were up on stage. That was the level that was demanded of the Talmidim in the yeshiva of which Rav Hirsch dreamt, and his son-in-law and his grandson were able to establish. Sometimes, you know, most of us when we read something, we don't bother with the footnotes. It's enough of an accomplishment for us even to read the text. Sometimes a footnote is very important. Let me give you, if you don't mind, let me give you a secular example of a footnote. There was a case that came to the Supreme Court in the 1930s. Caroline products versus the government. And there was a law which restricted commercial activity, and Caroline Products fought the law, and it went all the way up to the Supreme Court. They lost. Chief Justice Hughes wrote the opinion of the court, and he wrote a footnote. Footnote number four. And he said, that there's a difference between different kinds of cases. When a case involves monetary matters, commercial matters, then we must give the presumption to the legislature, to the Congress, that what they do is constitutional. But when we're dealing with basic liberties, then the court is required to give more careful scrutiny. So when it's a matter of personal freedom or religious freedom or freedom of the press, the court must carefully scrutinize any law. Right? It's just a footnote. But that footnote transformed constitutional law in the United States. And lest you think that this footnote does not matter to us, it matters to us a great deal. Because this means, and it has meant in many cases, many Supreme Court cases and cases throughout the country, because a Supreme Court decision governs the law, governs the courts throughout the country. It means that if there is a law passed that would infringe upon religious rights, the court must give that very strict scrutiny, and unless there's a compelling state interest, the court must declare that law unconstitutional. You remember a case of an area in Rockland County, just outside of Muncie, Suffern, that declared itself a separate village and tried to bar certain kinds of construction, which was intended to prevent Orthodox Jews from building there. Came to the courts, went through the courts. It was declared unconstitutional because the effect of this zoning provision was to deprive people of their religious liberty, of their right to worship as they saw fit. And here's just one footnote. Why am I talking about footnotes? There's one footnote in letter 18 of the 19 letters that I think for us, for every single one of us, this describes not only Rav Hirsch's attitude toward Torah, but we have to absorb this within ourselves. A word here about the proper method of Torah research. Two revelations are before us: nature and Torah. The same method of investigation must apply to both. In other words, I won't read the whole thing. Here's what he says. You know, the scientific method. What's the scientific method? You have to gather all the facts. And then you want to construct a theory which will explain the facts. And if this theory is correct, it will enable you to go further. Cancer treatment, anything, physics, engineering. If you understand the basic principles, then you can build on those principles. That's the scientific method. But you have a theory, you have 100 facts. Your theory explains 99 of them. When it conflicts with the 100th fact, then your theory is wrong. Your theory is wrong. You know, you can't very well say that the law of gravity is unconstitutional. It is. It's a fact. It exists. If your theory can explain it, fine. If your theory can't explain it, there's a book by a modern historian, Paul Johnson, where he says that one of the crucial times in modern history, and he calls it even the most crucial time, was sometime in the 1917, I don't remember the exact day. According to Einstein's theory of relativity, a certain event should have happened in the heavens. And if it had not happened, then it would have disproven the theory of relativity. But it happened. It happened. And that proved the theory of relativity. And modern physics is based on the theory of relativity, based on Einstein's theory. Nuclear power resulted from that. And Rav Hirsch says, Torah is like the scientific method, it's like nature. Every single thing that you find in Torah, Nevi'im, Ksuvim, in Shas, these are our facts. These are our facts. They are as immutable as the law of nature. And you can come up with, modern orthodoxy, ethics, come up with all the theories you want, which is really saying that I have to construct my worldview of Yiddishkeit according to what's popularly on the editorial page of the New York Times. That's really what it amounts to. If your theory does not fit what the Torah says, what Tanakh says, what the Talmud says, it is wrong. And that, in a nutshell, is the basis of Rav Shamshin Fraul Hirsch, and it has to be our basis as well. It has to be our basis as well. Let me close with a pshat from Rav Shamshin Fraul Hirsch. And I think that if we're wise and if we're capable and we're willing to make the effort, we have to construct or reconstruct our lives according to this. Yosef brings his father, he brings Yaakov Avinu to Paray. Paray looks at Yaakov Avinu and he says, Kama yimei shnei chayech. How many are the years, the days of the years of your life? Now think about it. Isn't that a stupid question? Can you imagine you're coming, you're being introduced to the president, to the governor, and he says, how old are you? What kind of question? And then Paro is the ruler of the most advanced nation in the world. How old are you? What kind of question is that? And how many are the days of the years of your life? Days, years. And what does Yaakov answer him? Yimei shnei chaya ma'at v'loim hein. They're few, not of great quality, like you, that did not reach the days of the years of my father and my grandfather. The man asked you a question. Maybe it's not a smart question. He asked you a question. He said, how old are you? Tell him how old you are. Tell him 130 years old. And I'm not as old as my father and my grandfather. You're still alive. Maybe you'll become as old. What does it mean? What's going on here? Listen to what Rav Hirsch says. Paray is not interested in the chronological age of Yaakov Avinu. He sees standing before him, obviously, a very great man. You must have heard a lot about him from Yosef. But just seeing him, you see a Yaakov Avinu, you see you're in the presence of greatness. How many of the days of the years of your life did you accomplish great things? What are the highlights of your life? Your great accomplishments, the days, how many days count? Let me give you an example. There was once a time when Americans were taught to be patriotic. The oldest people here might remember that. Where we were taught to believe our country, to believe our leaders, to love our country. Nathan Hale. Know the name Nathan Hale? Nathan Hale was a spy for the American forces in the Revolutionary War. And he was caught. So a young man, 27, 28 years old. He had been a school teacher. School teachers never amounted to very much in the United States. And he was a spy, not a very good spy, he got caught. And spies in the good old days were hanged. And the noose is around his neck, and he's standing on the chair, and they're about to kick it out from under him. They ask if he had anything to say. And he said, my only regret is that I have but one life to give for my country. My only regret is that I have but one life to give for my country. And for over 200 years, American school children have been told what Nathan Hale said just before he was executed. How long did it take him to say that? 5 seconds, 6 seconds, 7 seconds? How long did he live? 5, 6, 7 seconds. Nothing else in his life mattered. But those 5 or 6 or 7 seconds inspired people, millions and millions of people for hundreds of years. Parayas Yaakov Avinu, how many are the great days of your life, the great days of accomplishment of your life? How many days mattered in your life? And Yaakov says, Ma'at v'royim hem. Not many. And even the good days weren't so great. I didn't approach the greatness of my father and my grandfather. Yaakov is wrong. Yaakov is wrong, not because Nosson Scherman says so. The Torah says so. Vayechi Yaakov me'eretz Mitzrayim. Yaakov lived in the land of Mitzrayim. Vayechi Yimei Yaakov Shnei Chayov. The days of Yaakov, the years of his life, every day was important, every day counted. Every day mattered, every day accomplished something. Raphael Hirsch lived many days, 80 years of important days. And because he did, we are here. Because he did, countless tens of thousands of Jews, millions of Jews, since his time, lived, not just vegetated,